Hello, I'm Jason Solomons. Welcome to Seen Any Good Films Lately from Cannes, where new stars of cinema are born in the best films in the world.
The films I love, he's in it. He's iconic.
I love the title of your podcast. It's very charming.
My favourite, I think, if we're talking Palme d'Or material, is Lucas Daunt's Close, which is only his second film.
I've got model and actress Charlbi Dean. I've got director and star Lotvi Nathan and Adam Bessa from Harka. And I got some of the best roundup opinion with my critical guests. It's Qu'est-ce que t'as vu de bien? As they say down here, the last of this season. Seen any good films lately? From Cannes. So we're bringing season three of the podcast to a close in the most sunny and stylish of ways with my final show from this year's Cannes, the 75th Cannes 2022. So let's get right into some recommendations for you. Obviously, you can't see these movies yet, but they're coming your way throughout the next few months. Don't worry about that. So let's hear about some favourites from my first critics. They're like the Phil Schofield and Holly Willoughby of film festivals. John Bleasdale and Joe Titmarsh. Lovely to see you in Cannes. It was a good festival or a so-so festival, the 75th festival? Where does it sit?
It's not the best festival I've been to, but I've seen a couple of really great films that I've loved. After Sun is my top film, followed very closely by the David Bowie documentary.
Tell me about After Sun. That's the hot title that I have been a complete moron and missed.
After Sun is really a two-hander about a father and daughter on a package trip to Turkey, and it's nostalgic and beautiful and funny and sad.
And British.
And British. Great, great performances, brilliant debut. Directorial debut. She also wrote the screenplay, Charlotte Wells, so she's going to be one to look out for in the future.
And it's got that bloke off of Normal People in it, Paul Mescal. Is he good?
He's great.
Is he?
Yes, absolutely brilliant, yeah. And works so naturally and beautifully with the girl whose name I can't remember, but she was wonderful. Francesca Corio, I think she's called.
And why is it called After Sun? Because they go on holiday.
They go on holiday, and there's always a beautiful moment every night where they put After Sun on each other's faces. It's just adorable. I loved all of it.
Yeah, you really did. People have loved it. It's been one of the hot titles and British. And we played in Critics Week, so it's slightly hidden away.
A sidebar event. But it was packed and good word of mouth, and I think everyone's going to really want to see it.
Yes, and it has been picked up, so it will be seen. John, did you see After Sun as well?
Yeah, I loved it. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the only thing I'd say is in terms of it, the general, how good the festival is generally, it's not like a huge film. It's a very intimate film, and it's a very sort of focused film. So, it's okay that it was in a sidebar, but it was top class.
Yeah, everyone seems to have gone and sort it out and come back. And I think it's been picked up by probably Mubi.
Mubi do everything, don't they? I think it occurs on a Mubi.
Yeah, I'm guessing Mubi. It's normally correct. Now, you mentioned the David Bowie documentary. That's Moon Age Daydream. You enjoyed that?
I loved it. Even if it had been bad, which it absolutely wasn't, you just get to watch David Bowie looking sexy and being funny for 2.5 hours.
Hold on, so it's a documentary of found footage?
It's all footage, yeah. There are no kind of talking heads, no interviews, other than old interviews with David Bowie himself.
And it's composed of them from Hibs, from Cracked Actor all the way through to sort of concert footage? And
yeah, we've got concert footage, backstage footage, and some interviews with him.
And I think it takes its lead from the fact that he really considers himself a really multimedia artist, and they put all of that into the film. And best thing of all, no tin machine. So they skip that quite.
Skip that one. I saw that concert. What's the one I saw? I don't know why I got unlucky. Yeah, are you a Bowie fan, Joe?
I'm a huge Bowie fan.
And did this bring it all back? Why? What it was about him that you love? Well, do you know what I mean? We've seen so much Bowie stuff since his death, and so much kind of Bowie Day, Bowie Week, Bowie this. Like, I mean, I was a little bit like, oh, how much Bowie do you need? Do we need some more Bowie?
We definitely need more Bowie, and this is the film that gives it to you, I think. just because it's all about him, and like John said, you see all of the media that he used, and it was really fascinating, and just a real treat to kind of have him back with us.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're right, he's a multimedia artist, he's a performer in so many ways. Do we see that on the screen? We're reminded of that, because, you know, I think we can be just think he's a musician in some way. This brings it all.
Oh, yeah, they use clips from the Nicholas Roeg film and the Tony Scott film, The Hunger, but also they remind us of how in his stage performances he was incorporating a lot of Japanese theatre, and he's doing sort of dances with masks. I kind of forgot what a good dancer he is and how much he incorporates that into his act, and obviously has his personas, Ziggy Stardust, Aladdin Sane, the Thin White Duke, which is a little bit dodgy, and they definitely soft soap the dodgy bits. There's no sort of his flirtation with the far right, massive drug use, and, you know, his sexual sexcapades are somewhat sort of skated over, but, you know, in a way that's fine as well.
Is it a biopic, or it's just a sort of a look at his, because it tends, if you say goes to Black Star, it goes in order, isn't it?
No, it sort of mixes it up a lot, and it doesn't, you occasionally get little bits about his family, a little bit about his brother who had schizophrenia and he was hospitalized, and you have these little moments, but it's really about him, you know, being that star man that we you know, that is somewhat outside of human understanding. I mean, if that's not too pretentious a way of putting it, but that's kind of how it goes. And I mean, it's in the title, Moon Age Daydream.
Is that taken from a lyric?
It's a song, Moon Age Daydream. Oh yeah, I can do the whole thing.
It's like he's in the room.
Yeah. But it also tells the most brilliant love story between him and Iman, and that is just incredible. It's like a legend.
Yeah. I mean, I've always been very happy for both of them in that scenario. It wasn't like, when Helena Christensen was with Michael Hutchence, she was like, well, you know, he got a bit lucky there.
Yeah.
But with him, I thought that was great, great work. I was reminded of Iman in this festival when I was watching George Miller's film 3,000 Years of Longing, because it looked like the Michael Jackson video to Remember the Time.
Oh, yes.
And she's
with Iman in that, with Eddie Murphy. Yeah.
And I just thought, why does this film? I thought that film stank to high heaven. Did you see?
I didn't see that. No, I really wanted to, because I love George Miller, and beyond Mad Max, I love Babe, Pig in the City, and I love Lorenzo's Oil and Witches of Eastwick. So, it's a bit disappointing to hear. Although we sometimes disagree, so I might enjoy it.
Yeah. What's your little gems where Joe's mentioned those two, which you chimed in with her there?
Well, I definitely would hitch my wagon to Joe's horses there. But it's also Triangle of Sadness. I really loved. It's a heavy-handed satire against the one percenters, but when you're punching people, it makes sense to be heavy-handed, I think.
Someone said that it's like shooting fish in a barrel. I was like, yeah, but those fish really need shooting.
Yeah, and they're slippery sods, and a good machine gunning would do the world of good, I think.
Dynamite.
Absolutely, and it's really there's a Monty Python-esque grotesquerie to the comedy, which I really respond to. I love that exaggeration, and he exaggerates in every sense in terms of the nature of the humour, the boldness, and the length of the scenes. You think the joke is finished, and then he tops it and tops it and tops it, and I'm really all for that. I loved it.
He does do that. I mean, with Force Majeure, it's the avalanche coming towards you, and in the Palme d'Or winning the Square, it's that scene at the dinner party that the fun raiser where the monkey just keeps on giving, and he does it here. And I actually thought that there was such a lot of great filmmaking going on in this film. It's probably not as good as the others, but some people said it was better than The Square.
Oh, I think it was much better than The Square. Yeah, I thought the Square was, wait for it, oblong. that was prepared.
You've been waiting, what, 5 years to do that?
I was in my review. I'm just quoting my review. No one else will, so I might as well. But no, I thought The Square, it went after the modern art world, and as deserving as they might be of ridicule, they're not evil. Whereas the one percenters and the arms dealers and the billionaires of the world kind of are.
So try and understand this. I think it's a good shout-out for that one this week, because it has sort of divided people, and I thought,
I think that's the overriding thing of the whole festival, to tell you the truth. I don't think there's a clear winner. Anybody, you know, we've had Claire Denis, we've just watched the Kureida, the Japanese film, who's won the Palme d'Or in the past.
He's not going to win it again for this, is he?
No, not at all. This is a really much weaker... I mean, I enjoyed it. He's still a great filmmaker, so he doesn't make bad films. But it's very serious, Serie B, I was going to say. Championship? It's a championship version of the... Yeah, no, so, but I don't think there is that... Unless something comes really late, as in tomorrow, there isn't a sort of an amour or a blue is the warmest colour, some film that just really stands out and everybody nods and says, OK, this is taking
I have felt that the Park Chan-wook film, Decision to Leave?
Yes.
I think that's what it's called, Decision to Leave. For me, it stands out head and shoulders as the best one here. I didn't particularly love it. I just thought, that's got something going on for it. And, you know, he is a top-level filmmaker, having done Old Boy and won here. He hasn't won the Palme d'Or. Feels like...
Cool. Yeah, possibly. I mean, I really liked the film. I really admired it. But it wasn't as good as The Handmaiden, and it wasn't as good as Old Boy. And it just makes it feel a bit weird that it would win, and those other films which were in competition, at least The Handmaiden was, didn't.
I give you Deepan from Jacques Audiard, not his best film.
No, absolutely not.
Because sometimes they like to sort of catch up. Did you see The Park Chan-wook?
Yes, I did, and I felt a little bit like you, Jason, like a very good film, and... but I was disappointed in it somehow, and I just couldn't stand all of the mobile phone stuff. It was so convoluted.
It wasn't as if he was like, I'm going to show you how to do mobile phones on the screen. This is how you do it.
But beautiful to look at, you know, beautifully filmed and great acting. I absolutely love the two leads.
What was it about again? It was like a Hitchcockian...
It was a noir. It's like a noirish thriller. You know, the poor copper who was totally set up from the beginning in a very classic style. You know, happily married. You know, the great cop. Yes, and the femme fatale arrives.
So. And I do like that sort of stuff when he gets hold of it and sort of filters classic Hollywood style through the Korean thing. And I think that might... That would seem interesting. But it did, then it twisted. It just kept going.
Yeah, I totally went with it. I did talk to a few people who, as it often happens in festivals, take 5 minutes to have a little nap in the film. And this film was unforgiving. If you did that, you'd forget it. You lost it completely. Because there would have been a double cross or a triple cross while you had your eyes closed. So, no.
What about Elvis from Baz Luhrmann? Big, big event here. I saw that this morning. I think you've seen it as well. Slightly... mixed reviews for it, but I think you quite enjoy shaking your hips to that.
I loved it. I really did. I mean, I don't think it's a masterpiece or anything like that, but for what it does, it's exactly what you'd expect from Baz Luhrmann. It's noisy, it's glitzy, it's full of bling, it's full of sequins and stardust and kinetic energy and all that stuff, and it really fits with the material, especially the Vegas years, but even the 50s, all those shiny cars and everything, just absolutely gorgeous. And the music was really well done, and the sort of hip-hop elements that he uses actually didn't clang as loudly as they sometimes do.
Well, Gatsby, they
well,
clang.
Exactly, Gatsby, the material just didn't fit the style, because it fitted having DiCaprio play Gatsby, but it didn't fit F. Scott Fitzgerald at all. The only criticism I would have is I don't think the Tom Parker, the Colonel character played by Tom Hanks, is interesting enough a perspective. I found we spent a bit too much time with him, and I didn't think he was an interestingly complicated character. He's just a fraud, and people knew that at the time, even though, you know, it was revealed later how much of a fraud he was, spoilers. Even at the time, there were lots of distrust, you know.
I thought that was what the film was going to be about, this Tom Parker thing, and it wasn't quite about that. It's called Elvis, not Park. I didn't quite know what it was going to be, what it was about in the end.
Yeah, I was a bit disappointed. I felt a bit like John. There was a lot to love about it. I thought the lead, whose name I can't remember,
he
was
Austin
somebody or other. He looked amazing. He really looked like Elvis. He moved like Elvis. And as John mentioned before to me, you know, lots and lots of action in the kind of groin area for us. Lots of close-ups and. If you were a
girl in the 50s, and there are a lot of them in there, and it's all about, like, he was such a strange character. You talk about Bowie being an alien. That was sort of what Elvis was supposed to be, and they'd never seen anything like it. Would you have screamed?
Yeah, are you kidding? I was screaming
in the screen room.
Interesting. It's certainly a big event here, and Baz Luhrmann always is. He's such a showman, and I felt there was a lot in there that is very Baz. You know, the carnival and the sort of the big wheel and the circus aspect of it. I think maybe he was pulled a fraud on us. I don't know. I think it'll do well, Elvis. Really, I think people will go and see it.
I think it'll be a hit. I mean, this is one of the strange sort of double faces of this festival. Is we have had these enormous films like Top Gun Maverick with flyovers. Addirittura, going over during the red carpet with Tom Cruise, and then we had Elvis with, you know, Maneskin and huge celebrity guests there, and so there has been these big films and this big buzz, but there are also films that a lot of people have already seen or really right already in cinemas. And they don't. That's not really what a festival's about. It's not about a press junket for the films that are out this week. It should be much more like what's going on this year. And in that respect, I feel like the competition and a lot of the selections haven't really sort of. I've got a feeling Venice will have a lot stronger program.
Do you think that the last couple of years, the pandemic, the fact that people have seen things on links and that perhaps the business of watching them and has changed a bit? Well, I mean, in London there were sort of preview screenings. I've never seen so many before. That people have got a bit loose about. I know people were watching things on links on their laptops if they missed some screenings. See, that's the first festival I feel has been changed that way.
Well, no, because I do think we've had two years of very strange festivals, and indeed, you know, Berlinale was entirely digital or hybrid versions, and yet links are coming thick and fast for people in the industry and people in the press. But I do think the festivals, especially Cannes, need to maybe sit down and have a think about the experience of what going to a festival is like. And how they can change it and make it a little bit more comfortable for the people here and a bit more exciting as well.
A bit more. I get excited coming to Cannes. I get excited by cinema. But you're right, Venice, which is your hometown, Joe,
yes.
That always has like sort of the Oscar contenders will be unveiling there. You can't. You know, there's a Days at Venice where you suddenly see like three films in a row that will be sort of in the Best Picture category.
Yeah, but it has. It's a bit like a village fete compared to Cannes.
Well, it is for you because you live there.
No, but I think it is for most of us that work in that follow festivals. That here it's really business, and you feel that pressure even if you're not a part of it. And Venice just feels so laid back compared to Cannes.
It's true. And having delved into the business side of it this year, I can tell you, it's a bit of a bear
pit. Yes, you know more about that than we do, Jason.
Venice is far more relaxed than I am. Looking forward to it already.
Yeah.
guys, brilliant to have you. Oh, John, have you got a little gem that you've gone and found?
Oh, yeah,
like
I have, actually.
Pig?
Yeah, my truffling. It was actually the same day that I saw After Sun. I went down to the theatre... Quasette, and I saw this wonderful Canadian film called Falcon Lake. And if I tell you the synopsis, you will say, I've seen that film a million times, I've got no reason to see it. You know, it was the summer in which 14-year-old Luca fell in love with 16-year-old Chloe.
Oh, I love those films, though. They're my favourite.
Yeah. And, you know, but the summer would end, would change
their...
Exactly, yeah. In a world where... but it's surprising. It surprises you all the way through. The performances are wonderful. It looks great. It sounds fantastic. Has a lovely soundtrack.
Is it in Canadian English or is
it in French? No, well, actually, because the boy is coming from Paris, so his family is French. The friends are Quebecois, and there are some Canadian American boys around the corner as well. So there's a bit of a melange of languages. But it's just so well done, and it is a debut, so it's in the running for the Camera d'Or. So
I like the sound of that. You've sold that to me. Well, probably movie have beaten me to it. Joe Titmarsh, John Bleasdale, brilliant to have you. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Jason.
John and Joe are great mates of each other and of mine, and you can hear them chiming in together there really well with great choices. Do check out John Bleasdale's own podcast. It's called Writers on Film, and it interviews writers and journalists who've written books on films and filmmakers. Obsessives all. John's writing one on Terrence Malick right now, you know. And you heard John Bleasdale recommend Triangle of Sadness in his review roundup. That's the new one from Sweden's Ruben Östlund, Palme d'Or winner with The Square. And The film was a big centrepiece of this festival. It's about a male model, played by Harris Dickinson, and his more successful model influencer girlfriend, played by Charlbi Dean, who travel on a luxury yacht, which runs into a storm, and then the survivors are shipwrecked. It's a satire, a comedy of cringe and about moral dilemmas, and the breakout star of it is actress Charlbi Dean, more famous as a model throughout her career.
I started modelling at the age of, like, I want to say, like, literally 5 or 6 in Cape Town, and then I started travelling at the age of 13. So I started out first doing, like, drama school, and then I would do, like, acting at school, or not acting, like, theatre at school, and then I did, like, TV commercials, and then at one point I got a contract to go to Tokyo. And it was just a large amount of money for someone in a third world country. And they were kind of like, would you like to go for a month, 2 months, and you could come back and buy a house? Because that's the currency exchange. And my parents were like, bad idea, you're way too young. And I pleaded. And I got my way. But
yeah. How old were you?
13.
13. Mm. Are you still doing that?
You know what? It's modeling, but it's different. It's more, I would say, like advertising more for certain brands. It's done in the sense of being an actor instead of being a model. And there's a big difference between that. You know, as a model, you're a mannequin. You're essentially a hanger. You don't get a say on, like, what you wear, how you get perceived, if you like your lip color, if you like what you're wearing. And then as an actor, you have a say. People actually want to hear what your opinion is, which is bizarre. And I'm actually learning to find my own voice within that.
Were you allowed to get your opinion across working with Ruben Östlund?
I mean, there's definitely a hierarchy. Ruben is the captain, and you want it to be that way because you pick to be on his film. If you're lucky enough to pick or get chosen, rather, you want him to lead it because you trust what he does, right? And he's got such a clear voice. But that being said, he's never afraid of any ideas. In fact, he's open to them. I mean, you do so many takes that he's like, oh, if you have an idea, let's try it out. And every day we would have a little process of, like, improv before filming the next day, where you'd be like, this is what we're filming, let's play with it. What ideas come up? Let's see if it's actually going to be totally different mm-hmm. to what the script says.
Give us an example of a scene where that sort of happened and you managed to get something of you and your
Where we changed. I'm trying to think of what exactly. I think there were a couple times where Harry and I would both be like, no, I wouldn't behave that way. And then we would do it the other way, and it would maybe not be as interesting. And then Ruben would essentially be like, but if the situation were for these reasons, how would you respond then? And then I'd have to think, and I'd be like, okay, you know, if I think of Yaya having to travel at the age of 13, she's been working her whole life, she didn't finish school, so she doesn't have an education, now she's working, now she's close to 25 or whatever, and her career is going to end soon. She sends money back home to her family in South Africa or in Russia or wherever else, and then it's, what is next for her? She can't work, she doesn't have an education, she wants to have a family, and she needs to be with someone that is essentially going to take care of her and her future. It's not so much about the money, as more as about what's next for her, how's she going to survive.
And that's what's playing in your head as an actress.
100%. Yeah, you've got to love who you're playing, and you've got to understand where they're coming from, you know. And it's all the truth. That's what happened to me, it's what happened to most, it's what happens to most models.
Yeah. Have you seen Ruben's previous films when you were introduced to this project?
So growing up in South Africa, as much as I wanted to be an actor, I didn't necessarily have an industry of, like, people that, or like a family of people that watched film. You actually, at 7 o'clock at night, the TV goes off unless you have extra money to pay for the movie slots, which come on after. So ours would go off at 7 p.m. and I never really got to watch film. But I always wanted to do acting. And then when I was lucky enough to go to America, I kept saying to people, I want to be an actor, I want to be an actor. And the agents and teams would be like, well, what kind of films do you like? And I remember being like, I don't know, but how would I know if I didn't grow up with it? I just know this is what I want to do. Now I know why I wanted to do it, but at the time I didn't. And then I really got into, like, watching films. And one of the first films that I watched was Pan's Labyrinth with Guillermo del Toro. And I remember being like, wow, this is crazy. This is exciting. This is everything and more. And then I watched The Square Cup, obviously, later on, and The Angelica in New York. And I remember being, like, angry. I felt angry that I'd been missing out on films like this. I didn't know that people made films like that, you know? And I remember just being, like, excited and just, like, how do I become a part of that? Like, and then I just went crazy and watching absolutely everything. And when I was lucky enough to get the call, well, just an email being like, oh, you know, Ruben Oshland would like, you know, to see you improv this little scene. I'm going to be like, sure, whatever. There's no way he's going to watch my film. I'm never going to register. But this is cool. I'm auditioning for a Ruben Oshland film. And then when I actually got the call, like, I'd like to Zoom with you, I was like, sorry, what? Now it's real, and now I'm going to fuck it up. But, you know, you do, because then all of a sudden it's a real thing. But Ruben has this innate way of making everyone feel so comfortable, so calm. It's opulent. I'm being treated like a star, and it is obscure. And I keep saying to my agents, how do I say thank you? Because I'm so appreciative, but I don't know what the right etiquette is to show how thankful I am. But I don't want to go back to reality. This is marvelous. Who wouldn't want to be treated like this? Sorry if that's bad, but how lucky, you know? And I don't know how long it's going to last, so I'm taking up, you know, I'm just relishing in all of it, to be honest.
Did you put people right on how it works in the fashion industry and what that's really like?
He had a really good inside perspective already. And honestly, watching the film at the end, after, I mean, we discussed every little thing, and he'd ask me so many questions, always asking me questions. Ah, but what about this? And does this happen? Does this really happen? And he was often, like, shocked by what I would tell him. Because it's one thing being a photographer like his wife, and it's another thing being a model. You see a lot more. And in my opinion, the film is very true to that. When I watched the opening scene with the male models, I was just like, I was done. I thought it was hilarious. You know, I know some really, really big, big male models. And one of the things that they would do is they would buy, like, big bottles of champagne. And we're talking about guys that had no money in their wallets. They would spend their last cents on, like, even going into debt to buy something super fancy. And they'd go up to the casting directors and give it to them so that they would book them for their shows. And it sometimes works. One guy became the face of a very, very big brand in behaving this way. So, yeah.
The start when they do the serious, and Ruben knew this psychologically about the smiling is for a cheaper brand, it's serious, the Balenciaga H&M Balenciaga. Is that true?
We don't call it like Balenciaga and H&M, we'd call it commercial editorial. So commercial is more for your everyday inclusive brands that are more approachable, that everybody can wear on a day-to-day basis, that's welcoming and warm. Your top models generally won't do those things because it cheapens their brand, and then the more high-end things will be your more exclusive brands, and those tend to be more cool. When you do editorials, which are for magazines, they tend to be more cool, and those aren't as smiley and approachable. You're selling a dream, and you're selling a world that you wish to be a part of. So it's two different things.
How do you see things going for you from here, Charlbi?
Definitely keep acting. I mean, like I said, I started out acting. I was doing drama and theatre and all of that. And I didn't really have an opportunity to go to America without doing modelling. Because with modelling, you get a visa from your agency. And to do that for acting, it's impossible. Especially when you have a green, we call it the green mamba, which is a South African passport. So now that I'm actually in America and I have an American passport now, I can do acting, which was not the case. Even when doing this film, I had a really, really hard time with just having a green card. But the dream is to continue acting and to keep working with people like Ruben. That's my dream. I'd like to be like Tilda and be able to work with directors before they become huge and be able to read a script and be like, I can see the potential. That's who I want to work with.
The Tilda, you've spoken to Tilda about this?
No, I just know her film choices, and I always think that she sees things before it happens. I think she's just a genius.
And you can see Charlbi Dean and me doing our best Balenciaga H&M faces on my Instagram. And watch out for her in Triangle of Sadness with its bravura scenes, the centerpiece scenes that will be among the most talked about for months to come. Time for some more recommendations now with my next critical guest, the intrepid, ubiquitous, tireless BBC Film Festival reporter, Emma Jones.
My favourite, I think, if we're talking Palme d'Or material, is Lucas Daunt's Close, which is only his second film. So if you think of Xavier Dolan as a bit of a wonder kid, well, this is another wonder kid, really.
Yeah, he did Girl.
He did Girl. He won the Camera d'Or for Girl. and now he's back and got straight into competition with his second film, and now we understand why, having seen it, really.
Well, I'm off to see that next, but you've had an early screening, and it's just...
Yeah, an earlier press screening, and it's just beautiful. Hey, it's also only about 90 minutes long, which is, you know, which is amazing. It's really beautiful. It tells a story of two boys on the cusp of being teenagers, really, who are amazing friends. They're just like brothers. They're really, really close, mm-hmm. as the title suggests. And something happens, and one of them pulls back. And it's just... it begins. It's so beautiful. It's shot through with golden light at the start. It's, you know, I think it's Lucas's way of sort of recalling childhood. Then it becomes that the colours in itself, it's like a painting almost. It becomes much darker, much greyer as the film progresses. And amazing performances by the young leads. And I think, you know...
Well, he's obviously got a gift for that, because the performance in Girl... young dancer was amazing.
I think he's just got the whole deal, really. He's a very, very gifted storyteller. Yeah. His eye for framing is incredible. And I think he's barely 30
he's
as well.
He's really young, and he's got great energy. I interviewed him when he was at the LFF once.
He's so nice.
He was charming, and his English was perfect. He was really cool.
He's a lovely guy. I interviewed him for Girl, and I've seen him at the Women in Motion red carpet earlier this week. He's just fantastic, a really big talent. And even if he doesn't get the Palm, I think he's obviously in the running for a prize. That film will get a prize.
Nice surprise as well. I think you're right. We've got nearly to the end of the competition. There hasn't been one that's kind of knocked anyone's socks off yet. Would you say that about the competition?
Probably, yes, though I haven't seen all the competition films for Disclosure. In fact, I preferred some of the films in uncertain regard. Yeah. For example, I couldn't understand why Mary Kreutzer's Corsage wasn't in the main competition.
Vicky Creeps,
and she's playing Empress Sissy of Austria, Elizabeth of Austria, who's a contemporary of Queen Victoria's. That's an incredible film. I cannot understand why that didn't end up in competition. But anyway, I guess Uncertain Regard needs some really, really great movies as well. So I think Decision to Leave by Park Chan-wook is probably the nearest to everybody having their socks knocked off.
Yes, I agree.
But I think it was quite hesitant. It was almost like, well, this is probably the best we've seen so far, but do we really think maybe the same way that we think of it as Old Boy or, you know, any of his other work? The last 20 minutes of the film, people listening, is incredible. You know, it's the last 20 minutes of the film that make it for me.
I prefer the first 90.
Oh no. Well, anyway, I love it. This reminds me of the piano. It's that soaring emotion, yeah. the soaring, sweeping views
exactly.
of the sea, that
right.
that kind of thing.
Right.
I thought it was
epic. Yeah. By country mile, the best sort of thing that I'd seen.
Another one, and Broker, I really enjoyed that. Of course, Corey Ader's movie, and he is also a Palme d'Or winner for Shoplifter. I really, really like that.
It's sort of in his wheelhouse, although it's in Korea. Most of his films are Japanese, of course, apart from the one that was at Venice, which was French.
Very much family-oriented,
yeah,
he loves
families. Odd families are found in various places.
Yeah.
Like
I found it quite mainstream, actually. Mm. I think it was more of a crowd-pleasing movie, quite mainstream. I wouldn't be surprised if that got prizes.
It's got that sort of almost Dickensian melodrama, because we're dealing with sort of child trafficking.
Sorry, everybody. It's about child trafficking, and it's about a baby box in Busan where people can drop off their unwanted babies. But
amazing.
There's a trafficking ring around it as well. But it remains a very heartwarming tale. And I suppose you could argue that he's not really, really dealing with this issue, which is clearly an issue that you know, probably the world over, but instead it's a very sympathetic portrait of the baby traffickers, you know, and people who are willing to sell their babies. So all right, so that's fine, but I really like the film. I do really, really like the film.
I like Corey Ader a lot. He's one of my favourite filmmakers. So who have you, give us some not gossip, but like interviews. You interview so many people on a can, it comes a blur,
as do you. Yes. And it all becomes a blur, doesn't it? I really enjoyed my interview with Pier Francesco Favini
for
Nostalgia. He's here with an Italian film, Nostalgia, which I think is in competition,
isn't it?
Yes, I've lost the plot by now. But he was wonderful. We had a really, I think that might be my favourite interview, actually.
He's a very charming man. Oh, I can understand you.
He's a very beautiful, charming, intelligent man, yes. And enjoyed talking to him about Naples, because the film is all about somebody going back to Naples after more than 40 years. And, you know, of course, Sorrentino captured Naples beautifully last year in Hand of God.
They're quite different
Very
portraits.
Different movies. But it almost felt like a travel chat, really, to be honest with you, you know. And I think, I don't know if you've been watching Stanley Tucci's, Italian journeys on TV. I think we ended up talking
you
about
think
that.
Favino should
that
get his own
lovely.
Show.
Why not? Why not send him round, you know?
You'd be his camera person.
Indeed, yes. Yes, indeed. What else did I enjoy? Speaking to David Cronenberg was amazing. Had some time with him. Really, really lucky.
Strange film, that one. What is David Cronenberg?
Pretty strange, yes. I was lucky enough to speak to all the cast. I'm really impressed with Kristen Stewart, actually. She is such an intelligent young woman. Really enjoyed speaking to her. She probably got it more than the rest of us. I think she might have even got it more than David Cronenberg did.
The film was.
She really understood it and was able to say.
Oh, what is it now? I couldn't bloody work it out.
I don't know. I can't remember.
So many of the films. I'm not sure what they're about, to be honest. But Cares film, I didn't know what that was about.
Oh, I haven't seen that one. But David Cronenberg's was lovely, and in the sense that he was lovely, and his press conference was great as well. I haven't seen the Elvis film or the Elvis press conference. I think they were great. Mm-hmm. I think we've had some
showman, old Baz Luhrmann.
It's amazing. But I think we miss David Cronenberg when he's not around at Cannes, not because of the body shock horror, which of course we had his descendant last year with Titan winning the Palme d'Or, but I think we miss Cronenberg when he's not here because he's such an intelligent, funny man, and self-deprecating as well, and it's really just good to have that kind of time with those kind of directors who really, even though I'm sure they do take their work seriously, they don't take themselves that seriously.
What can we expect from the Talking Movies Part 2, the second edition?
Well, thank you for asking. I think that we can expect a South Korean film special, which of course incorporates Hunt being premiered by the star of Squid Games. Of course, we've had a real lot of Korean films. And Broker.
He's in the Koreeda.
Exactly. And it is Koreeda's film was also filmed in South Korea.
Yeah, Busan, isn't it?
Yeah, I've got my David Cronenberg interview, of course.
Brilliant.
And my colleague has also been looking at the Ukrainian films here at the festival and those stories, and also Tchaikovsky's Wife, of course. So he's been looking at those aspects.
A good can, Emma, from your point of view?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, definitely. Do you know what? I think I preferred last year's can. I was so happy with Titan winning.
I thought all the films were brilliant last year. I mean, they were all really good. I think much better than this year.
I know, and there were so many films I came out, including Jacques Audiard, which just wasn't even his best, going, oh, I'm so honoured to have seen that. Maybe it's because we were really starved of cinema at that point, and we were just so happy to be back. I think it's been brilliant just seeing Cannes back to normal, you know, the crowds, the parties, the dinners, you know, the films, masks on a voluntary basis. It's been really, really wonderful seeing that. I don't know it's been the best year for cinema, even though it's the 75th anniversary, and so they've clearly pulled out all the stops. We're getting in the big-name directors for the competition.
Oh, flypast from the Red Arrows for Tom Cruise.
Oh, by the way, I am also on Talking Movies. I think we're coming to part three now, looking at the Uncertain Regard competition as far as female directors are concerned, because there were some really good films in there, including War Pony. I don't know if you saw
Elvis's
that.
Elvis's granddaughter.
Riley.
I did see it. Everyone said that was great.
Really, really good. And Rodeo by Lola Quiveron, which I think is in competition for the Camera d'Or.
Yeah.
So we've gone for those films rather than going for the films in competition. You know,
I think smart choice,
and,
you know, because that's where the female filmmakers are of the future, definitely.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's been really heartening, though, of course, there were plenty of headlines, deservedly so, about why start off with three and then you kind of push it up to five. Can I just mention one more film that I do really like?
Yeah,
I wonder if you
really
like Eight Mountains. It's not a little gem, it's about 2.75 hours long. But did you enjoy Eight Mountains?
I miss Eight Mountains, which is annoying because it's set in a place where I've been skiing. And I thought, why have I didn't see that? I didn't know it was set in the Aosta Valley.
I do hope it gets some kind of acknowledgement, because everybody I know has really liked it.
Yeah, I heard like a bit meh and I didn't catch up, and then people went, oh, but you'd really like that one, too.
Yeah.
It's kind of contemplative and beautiful and European.
Yes, absolutely. And it's about, again, wow, an intense friendship between two young men who grow up. It's based on a book. They're not lovers. I think if you watch it, you might spend most of the movie going, shouldn't they be? Really? If they're such soulmates? I don't know. But really great performances, beautiful vistas.
I'm friendly with some of my male mates without being
wasn't
lovers with them.
I absolutely agree with that. But it's just if you watch the movie, it might be quite ambiguous.
They do a lot of camping under the stars.
I don't know, yeah.
Does it look amazing? I mean, it's just the mountains look amazing, apparently.
They are amazing. I'll tell you which is an amazing film in terms of its cinematography is Godland in Uncertain Regard. That's an Icelandic movie. And truly, Iceland looks Tolkien-esque under that lens. It looks like fairyland almost. Mm-hmm. The green dells and, you know, the ice and fire of the volcanoes. It looks absolutely magical. But yeah, eight mountains and that kind of, it's almost Heidi-esque in terms of its alpine vistas and wholesomeness. You know, when you're looking, you think, oh, why do I live in London? Why don't I just get some fresh air in the Alps? It's been good.
But that's what cinema can do, make you travel without a passport. And for 2.5 hours, you were in those Alps.
Absolutely. Well, that was the great thing during COVID, I guess.
Thank you so much.
Thank
Looking
you.
Forward to those talking movies and glad to have been a part of a reciprocated arrangement.
Pleasure, absolutely. See you again very soon.
Emma's always worth listening to, and you can find her on BBC World's Talking Movies with Tom Brooke and me. Now you know I like to bring you the newest voices in film on these shows, because Cannes is as much about discovery as it is the big stars. In fact, it's about both those things and how they coexist together. We've had that Juliette Binoche on the show, and still my favourite film of the festival, if I'm honest, is Mia Hansen-Love's One Fine Morning with the brilliant Léa Seydoux performance. That was on the show last week. Catch up with that if you missed it. Mia's already won the Europa Cinemas Label Prize for Best European Film in Director's Fortnight. So, you know, I pick the winners and bring them to you. And up for this year's Camera d'Or for Best First Film is Harka by Lotfi Natan. It's a film about an illegal gasoline seller on the streets of Tunis, and it's the way society can shut out a young man and kill all his hopes until tragedy ensues. The lead role is magnetically played by a young actor called Adam Bessa. I think he's a real star in the making, so I went to meet him and his director to find out more about Harka.
I love the title of your podcast. It's very charming.
Tell me who you are and what your film is here and what you're doing here.
I'm Lotfi Nathan, director of Harka. And we're here for our world premiere.
How did it go?
It was very intense for us and powerful for us to show it that way and finally share it with an audience in such a big way. It was very exciting.
Yeah, and here's your star, Adam. Adam, come introduce yourself, a breakout star of Cannes 2020.
Oh, hello, nice to meet you guys. My name is Adam Bessa and I'm playing Harka, Lotfi Nathan's film, yeah.
Tell me about Harka. He's a difficult character to, you know, we kind of love him, but we also think, man, calm down a bit.
Yeah, right. Exactly, yeah. He's complex. That's what we love, right?
Yeah.
That's what, I mean, the important thing is not to like or not dislike, it's to remember. I hope he'll remember him, you know?
I remember your face, I remember his actions. How do you get in the headspace of a guy like him? I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, you have the family problems. What, is it in the script? Did it help on the locations? How did all of it inform you?
Everything you said, you know? You're actually very good at your questions.
I've been doing this a long time, man.
Yeah, right? Yeah, actually very good. Yeah, yeah, exactly what you said, you know? The script, the location, working with Lotfi, you know?
Do you know any people like him?
Yeah.
That story comes from experience? Not personal, but, you know.
For certain elements, for sure. You know,
such as
in terms of feeling the frustration, I guess frustration. I saw powerlessness. You know, you can portray it a certain way that is maybe caricatural, but when you lived it and you saw people like that, you see the subtleties of it. You know, and it expressed in certain forms. I think the trick in this one is to express feelings that people can understand, but with subtleties, you know, with precision, you know, it's to be precise, you know, because anger, frustrations are huge mountains of emotion, like big volcanoes, you know, and it always can become something very, you know, demonstrative, you know. But in real life, in certain moments, you know, it becomes very, very precise.
You mentioned volcanoes. It's quite an explosive performance, quite an explosive movie. There's moments when you think, I mean, you know, how's he going to build it? How's he going to, you know, has he got further to go? He's such a sort of volatile character. And yeah, to your credit, you know, there's always another step to go. Well done on building that performance. How did you keep a lid on it? Obviously, he edited it well as well.
He was my metronome, you know. He was my guide, you know. I had, like, you know, trust in him, you know. I would just, like, bring the fuel, he would burn it, you know. I would just bring the material and he would, you know, work with it, you know. A volcano is something that is always on action, you know, you never know when, and that was the great thing to try to achieve, you know, when is it gonna blow up to my face, but still I can feel the earth shaking and I can feel everything, you know, and sometimes there are moments of calm, but then you go back again, and, you know, thanks to him, the edit team, you know, everybody that worked on it, and, you know, I could, and yeah, that was really the challenge to try to, you know, to find the right rhythm, and together we found.
How did you find Adam?
Adam was discovered by our lead producer Julie Vies. Someone sent his stuff, I think, for something else she was working on, and we were searching high and low at that time, and we were trying to audition a lot of actors, but that wasn't panning out, and also doing street casting, you know, but Adam just had this amazing quality right from the beginning, and his audition was great, his audition tape, because it was so low-key, and there was this decision to have restraint, I think, is really... I knew at that point from the other examples I'd seen that that was actually a decision, you know, to not do too much.
Yeah. Congratulations. Well, thank
you for having us.
My pleasure.
Yeah.
Have you managed to see any good films while you're here?
I saw Top Gun.
Yeah.
And also Armageddon Time.
Yeah, it was nice, yeah. Very, very lovely film.
Yeah. Top Gun?
No, I saw only Armageddon Time. Yeah, it was a very lovely film, yeah. Interesting.
I liked it.
In many,
much.
Many aspects.
Really
yeah.
Good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I was slightly... happily surprised. I didn't know it was going to be.
Well, that's what's cool about Cannes, you know, because you can go from a very intense and, you know, gut film to something very pleasant. And after a premiere, actually, now I look back to it, and it's actually the perfect movie to watch because it's so gentle, so warm, so, you know, so cuddly that I felt actually comfortable in the cinema, and watching that was just like a voyage, you know.
You gotta love Cannes. You see your film. You see Armageddon Time and you see Top Gun.
Top Gun. All in one place.
Like Top Gun?
I thought it was a blast.
Yeah. Well, you couldn't get two more different films and they're all together in Cannes.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Well done
right.
For all being... But right. For you and Tom Cruise sharing a space, that's kind of
oh,
nice,
yeah.
Right?
Hey, great to meet you.
Great to meet you.
Thanks
not
for
me.
Your time.
Adam,
Thank you.
Allez,
merci.
There you go, some new stars for you. That's Cannes 2022. I mean, it's not all of it, by any means. Myself, I saw a whole new side to things when I was pitching my producer projects around town. And it can be a bear pit if you're not prepared and strong and committed to your material. I popped the words into the right ears, I think. And more meetings back home will follow. And I had some highs and lows in doing it. Some yeses and nos and some maybes. And some come back when you've got a script and a director attached. And then we'll talk. And I got some fantastic advice and guidance from friends and from what I find is a very collegiate bunch of people, the film producers. And this Cannes was really about me telling people and you about my transitioning into a producer. Nothing more, too more dramatic. I met some big players and some people in the same boat as me. All of it serving the films we're seeing on the screens. All of it buzzing around Cannes. The excitement of making movies more infectious than any pesky virus has been. Was that a theme of the movies? The old corona, the old pandemic? I think we want to get rid of it, don't we? We don't want to talk about it at all. But there was definitely something residual in the films we saw that were probably made under pandemic conditions, many of them. And there was definitely something alienating in the theme, something about identity, people seeking connection, to belong, to fit in with others. It was in Claire Denis' Stars at Noon. It was in the Italian film Nostalgia. In Leonore Serrai's very tender Mother and Son. In Harka, which we talked about. In Corrieda's Broker. In the Dardenne's so-so film Tori and Lakita. It was even with the little donkey in the extraordinary Jerzy Skolimowski film E.O. And it was certainly in the heartbreaking story of intense child friendship, Close. All of these have characters feeling isolated and unloved and seeking to connect. So that might be them, but it's also been us these last couple of years, hasn't it? So that's my theme, my story, and my can. What will win? My tips are Close by Lucas Daunt, Decision to Leave by Park Chan-wook, The Actress, star from Petit Frère or Mother and Son, Ruben Östlund, saw him hanging around having dinner late last night in an Italian restaurant, so he's still here, so I'm thinking director. But it's all very much in the air this year, and up to the jury, isn't it? Thanks for joining me this season on Seen Any Good Films Lately. Thanks to all my guests throughout the season, from the new voices such as Charlbi Dean here and the huge stars such as Juliette Binoche and Kanjura and Noomi Rapace or Paolo Sorrentino, or award winners of the season such as Questlove and Ariana DeBose. All of it's been put together by the excellent Kate Dawkins, so we thank her very much. It's been an absolute pleasure bringing it to you. Thanks for listening. Let's go out, as we always do, with a tune. This one's a bit of a blast from the past. I really enjoyed hearing it. It features memorably in competition film Mother and Son, or Un Petit Frère, by Leonore Serrai, and she plays it almost in entirety, one of the kids dancing to it in a nightclub. It's about a family from Côte d'Ivoire trying to make it in Paris throughout the 80s and 90s and 2000s, directed by Leonore Serrai. And when I first saw it, I thought, no, I don't know about this one, but it's really lived with me. It's really stuck with me. Great performances, great music by the director, chosen by the director Leonore Serrai, this 90s hip-hop gem. I hadn't heard it for ages. It's Underwater Love by Smoke City. We'll go out with that. Au revoir.